Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Ramadan is upon us one more time. And as usual, you will start hearing and reading about Ramadan and how to make the best out of Ramadan. But in this title here, I am going to tell you how you can ruin and mess up your Ramadan. And I want to say why I have chosen this approach as opposed to just praising and getting you ready, all worked out to meet Ramadan. And that is because year after year after year of saying the same thing, but we Muslims are not really maximizing on Ramadan as we ought to. The main reason is not that there is a problem with Ramadan itself, but the main problem and the main reason is because we have given a different identity to Ramadan, a different identity to what goes in Ramadan, so much so that Ramadan comes in and goes out and not much is witnessed in a matter of change in the Muslims as a whole, nation, or individual. I have friends just like you have friends, but your friends, you don't see any difference in them before or after Ramadan. So why are we going wrong? I'm not going to tell you why we are going wrong, but I am going to tell you how you need, or what you need to do to go wrong, what you need to do to stay like last year, what you need to do to mess up your Ramadan and make it a simple act like any other normal act that you do on a daily basis. Again, why is it that it matters that you should mess up your Ramadan? Because by messing up something, and if we are in the business of learning, we will learn from that messing up. The problem is when we mess up and we don't realize that we are messing up, that's where the problem is. Look at it this way. Today in the world, especially in the Western parts here, if someone is fat, people call them big. So much so that if you say to someone, oh, you are fat, they will take that as an insult. But if you tell them you are big, they will feel some comfort in that they are not fat. This is deceptive. That's why the number of people get into obesity and they become obese is because there is a truth that is being hidden somewhere else. If a thief, we call them by their name a thief, they will get angry. But if we call them someone who takes people's things, that is less harmful than calling them a thief. And also, a liar, if you call someone a liar, they will get upset and offended. But if you tell them you don't say the truth, it's always less harmful and painful than when calling somebody a liar. Well, to us Muslims, it's the same thing. The more we tell people this is what you should do to get the best out of Ramadan, people still don't get the best out of Ramadan, and we don't see that in their daily lives. But if we start telling people, and that is my approach today, how you can mess up your Ramadan, then guess what? Then maybe you'll start thinking differently. As much as if someone injures themselves, we tell them, keep the wound clean. Maybe they will not get the real meaning of that. But if I tell them, put this and put that and do this and do that, and the wound will never heal, and it will get infected, and it's gonna get worse. Guess what? The person will pay double attention. And this is how it, I wanted this pep talk to go. I try my very best not to keep it long so that you guys, busy guys, can listen to it quickly and maybe get the best out of it, Allah knows. I wanna start by saying, when was Ramadan prescribed on Muslims? Because this is absolutely crucial, and you will see why. Well, Ramadan was prescribed in the year 2 after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated from Mecca to Al-Madinah. When he got to Al-Madinah, year 1 nothing happened. Year 2 Ramadan was prescribed just 1 month before Ramadan, and that was in Sha'ban. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fasted 9 years, i.e. 9 Ramadans he fasted after that. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, died after that, and then we carried on the journey without him. So what is the purpose of Ramadan? Why do we fast? Really, this is a question we need to ask. Why do we fast? Well, we have two different versions, or at least three versions that are being marketed today. There is what Allah says in the Quran, there is what the Ahadith say, and there is also what the general public say. Allah in the Quran has explained why we fast. But today we hear people saying that we fast because so that we can feel the hunger of people that cannot eat. And when we do that, then we donate more. But the reality of the truth is, it doesn't happen. People have fasted for so long and they still donate peanuts. So this argument is away. Others say, well, guess what? We fast because it's healthy. It helps our body clear the toxins and things like that. It could be a side effect of fasting. But is it the real reason as to why the purpose of Ramadan? Well, guess what? Not. And there is also the hadith, but the hadith, most of them go with the Quran. But even though there are some hadith that give different meanings, but because they contradict the Quran, we'll go with the Quran. There are two things when it comes to fasting, my dear sisters and my brothers. There is the fasting itself, and there is Ramadan. Ramadan is different than fasting. Ramadan is the time container of the action of fasting. So to speak, Ramadan is like a masjid. And in it, you perform not the salat, but the fasting. Why is that important? Because when I said is how to ruin your Ramadan, I do not mean the fasting. I mean the container, the time container. For example, if you have an exam that takes place on a Monday between 9 to 3, well, Monday from 9 to 3 is the container, the time container of what you're going to do, the activity of the exam. So I'm not ruining your exam. I'm more speaking about the Monday between 9 to 3. This is why when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Ramadan, He didn't say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kutiba alaykum Ramadan. Allah says, O you who believe, Ramadan has been prescribed on you. Allah doesn't say this. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, you who believe, kutiba alaykum as-siyam. As-siyam, the fasting, has been prescribed upon you, as it has been prescribed upon those before you. كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. So that you reach التقوى. And I will speak about this in a bit. So Ramadan is different than الصيام. الصيام is the act you do. Ramadan is when you do it. So these are two things. Okay, you really need to differentiate between them. Because when people fail miserably at changing, is not because of the fasting, the activity that they do in Ramadan. It's because they have not taken the period of time, the Ramadan, to change. Look at it this way. If you want to ruin your Ramadan, well, guess what? Then just ignore the meaning of Ramadan altogether. Just think of Ramadan as the month of what? Of fasting. But Allah doesn't say that. Allah says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. Allah didn't say, شهر رمضان الذي كتب فيه الصيام. Allah didn't say, the month of Ramadan is the month in which الصيام has been written. No, Allah says, شهر رمضان, the month of Ramadan, is what? Is the شهر in which القرآن was revealed. So in Ramadan, two things happened. Is we fast and Al-Quran was revealed. Now, if you want to keep ruining your Ramadan, then keep thinking that Ramadan and fasting are the same thing. They are not. Fasting is the activity that takes place in Ramadan, just like Hajj is the activity that takes place in Dhul Hijjah, and so on and so forth. So what is the purpose of Siyam, not of Ramadan, of Siyam? Is that we reach at-taqwa. But what is at-taqwa? Is it really fearing God, fearing Allah, becoming righteous? Well, at-taqwa is explained differently in Al-Quran. To ruin your Ramadan, keep thinking as the taqwa, as you being righteous and fearing Allah. Because no matter what you do, the majority of Muslims are not righteous and they don't fear Allah as they ought to. So at-taqwa has got to have another meaning. And who can explain to us the meaning of at-taqwa better than Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? And Allah explicitly has explained it in Surah Al-Ma'idah, of the latest of what has been revealed in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is the surah number 5, the ayah number 2, where Allah says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى, and cooperate with each other in the birr, in doing the birr. The term birr is a general term that refers to anything that is good that Allah wants us to do. It could be hajj, salat, it could even mean feeding a bird. Al-birr is all good that you can do that will help you on the judgment and they will score positively for you. So Allah tells us, so you humans, ta'awanu ala al-birri, so help each other, cooperate with each other for anything that is good. What taqwa and at-taqwa. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the opposite of these two. And he says, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا, and do not cooperate, عَلَى الْإِثْمِ. Al-ithm, the sin, is the opposite of al-birr, the good. And then he gives us a meaning that is the opposite of at-taqwa, and that is the true meaning of the word at-taqwa. And then Allah says, وَالْعُدْوَانِ, and al-udwan is aggression. So the word aggression is the opposite of the word taqwa. So when Allah says, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ, is it fear Allah? It doesn't mean that. So when someone transgresses against themselves, i.e. by doing a sin, what they will get out of that? A punishment from Allah. So when Allah says, wattaqullah, he means do not do an act that will get you the wrath and punishment of Allah. And when you do that, then when you commit a sin, you have committed aggression against yourself, and the repercussion of that aggression will hit you sooner or later. So to mess up your Ramadan, keep thinking that taqwa means you fear Allah and you are righteous and pious and you go to the masjid and you behave in certain manner in Ramadan. That's because that's what is expected of you. But absolutely not. That is not what is expected of you. The act of taqwa is that you do not become aggressive or show any aggression either towards yourself or towards every other human out there. Again, one thing to ruin your Ramadan is keep believing that Ramadan is a blessed month and tell people Ramadan Mubarak. Is Ramadan really a blessed month? Well, get what? There is absolutely no authentic hadith that says that Ramadan is Mubarak or that it has extra barakah in it than any other month, say Dhul Hijjah. Because Ramadan is not of the sacred months. Ramadan is just like Shawwal, like Rabi al-Awwal. It's like any other month except the 4 months that are sacred. The month of Ramadan is not even sacred. It's just a regular month. Is Ramadan blessed? Of course not. It is not blessed. This is why Allah, when he mentioned and spoke about Laylatul Qadr, Allah said that Laylatul Qadr is the only night that has barakah, that is blessed, and that is the only night in the whole month. What this means is the rest of the month is not blessed. This is why Allah says, Inna anzalnahu, i.e., we have indeed sent it down, and it here refers to Al Quran, fi laylatin mubarakah, in a blessed night. He did not say in a blessed month. When Muslims say Ramadan Mubarak, what they are saying is they are given a title that the whole month doesn't deserve. But can we say to someone Laylatul Qadr Mubarak? Of course, because Laylatul Qadr by the text of Allah in the Quran means that it has a blessing in it. So to ruin your Ramadan, to give it a different meaning that will get you results, keep thinking that Ramadan is blessed month. Well, guess what? Ramadan is not a blessed month. Ramadan is a container for the fast that you do. The only thing that is blessed in Ramadan is Laylatul Qadr, as Allah says in Al-Quran, Inna anzalnahu, we have indeed sent it down, fi laylatin mubarakah, in a blessed night. So my dear sisters and my brothers, keep believing that the whole month is blessed, because it is not. that the whole month is only a build up, as I said in previous talks, to Laylatul Qadr. The whole month is a workout to get the great results of meeting Laylatul Qadr, because that's where the blessings are. When Muslims believe that Ramadan is blessed, the whole month is blessed, Laylatul Qadr has lost its blessing. Laylatul Qadr has lost its true meaning and its true value. To further ruin your Ramadan and make it just a normal month like the previous ones, where it does not impact your life, keep believing that Ramadan is divided in three parts. Keep thinking that the first 10 days are mercy, and that the middle 10 days are forgiveness, and the last 10 days are a setting free card from hellfire. There is absolutely nowhere in the Quran where Allah mentions such things. And also, the hadith reported by Ibn Khuzaymah and Al-Bayhaqi has been classified by a plethora of scholars of hadith as a very, very weak hadith. And yet, because people think Ramadan's blessings, because once you start believing that Ramadan is blessed month, you need to find some reason as to why it's blessed. And that's where the 10 mercy days and the 10 mercy forgiveness and the last 10 setting free from hellfire days came about. So again, different perception, different understanding about Ramadan give you different results. To keep ruining your Ramadan, keep thinking that Ramadan is divided into three parts. Another matter that you need to keep doing to ruin your Ramadan, and that is to believe that in every Ramadan's night, Allah sets a lot of Muslims free from hellfire, or what is known in Arabic, itqun min al-nar. There is a huge belief that you need to keep believing in if you want to ruin your Ramadan, that every night Allah sets a great number of Muslims from entering hellfire. This belief is reported only in two hadiths mentioned in Musnad Ahmad and Ibn Majah, and also in the Tabarani. These hadiths about setting free from hellfire have been deemed weak in the past. But in our days today, there is a Sheikh Al-Arnaut and Sheikh Al-Albani alayhim rahmatullah, who have classified this hadith as good. And as such, people all around keep mentioning, and you hear them in the dua, Ya Allah, make us of utaqa'ak min al-nar, make us of those who are set free from hellfire. But the problem is that who asks to be set free from something? Is it somebody who is inside that thing, or someone from outside that thing? Let me put it this way. Who asks to be set free from jail? Someone who is already in jail, or someone who is out of jail? Have you ever asked Allah in your prayers, Ya Allah, set me from jail? Because no, you are not in jail. Who asks to be freed from a problem? Is it someone who is in a problem, or someone who is not in a problem? Where we all know, when you are in a situation where you need help, that's when you ask for help. Who asks to be saved from drowning? Is it someone who is in the middle of the sea and is about to drown? Or someone who is sitting at home on a comfortable sofa, watching some movie or just having some tea? Well, people believe that at the end of Ramadan, Allah will set free a much bigger number of people from the grip of hellfire that he didn't do during the month of Ramadan. And sadly so, this belief contradicts the whole purpose of judgment and accountability day. So if people are set free in this life, what's the purpose of them being raised on judgment day, receive their books, carrying their actions, and having them weighed, and then based on the outcome of the balance, either to paradise or hellfire? Or what's the purpose of on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala weighs the actions? فَمَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَهُوَ فِي عِيشَةٍ رَاضِيَةٍ. So whoever his actions are heavy in the balance, they will have a beautiful life. وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ, and whose actions are light, فَأُمُّهُ هَاوِيَةٌ, then he will fall headlong in hellfire. So what's the purpose of all that if Allah has set us free from hellfire? For you, a Muslim who's going to live 60 years, and say you fasted 40 years, Allah will answer your dua one of them years to set you free from hellfire. What that means is you are completely free from hellfire, because if Allah sets you free from hellfire, you're not gonna enter it. So why are we scared? Why do we have our actions weighed? Why? Where in Al-Quran does Allah says, Allahumma atiqna min al-nar? Ya Allah, set us free from hellfire. Throughout the whole entirety of Al-Quran, Allah always say to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to make us enter hellfire. Aqina adhab al-nar. Ya Allah, prevent us from the punishment of hellfire. Not get us out of hellfire, because we're not in hellfire. The people who are going to ask Allah to set them free from hellfire are people that are already in hellfire. And we Muslims, every year, or you Muslim, every year, you are in Ramadan, and the Imam who leads the Taraweeh, Allahumma atiqna min al-nar, Allahumma set us free from hellfire, and you say, Ameen. Are you already in hellfire? Of course not. Absolutely not. And that is only one sign on how we Muslims are really throwing Al-Quran away and following just the general public, the hadith here and hadith there. My dear sisters and my brothers, Allah doesn't set free anyone from hellfire because nobody is inside hellfire. Al-Quran points us to ask Allah to prevent us from entering hellfire, not to set us free from hellfire. So if you want to ruin your Ramadan this year, keep making the dua of being set free from hellfire, because what you are doing is you already considered yourself of the dwellers of hellfire. And this doesn't make sense at all. It doesn't. It makes my brain boil when I hear that. But again, if you want to ruin your Ramadan, keep believing that a shaitan is chained in hellfire, that people in Ramadan are free from a shaitan. And as I said, Ramadan doesn't have anything special about it. Yes, there are many ahadith that say that the shaitan is chained in hellfire and that this, and even so many people believe that in Ramadan their shaitan is not with them. And as such, they are actually goodies. Well, Al-Quran doesn't agree with that at all. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said to us that shaitan is our declared enemy all the times and everywhere, regardless of the day, night, time, and everything. Listen to what your Lord Allah says to you. Ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind, and this speech is to all the entirety of mankind. Because if a shaitan is kept in Ramadan in hellfire just for the Muslims, so why isn't the rest of the world having the opportunity in Ramadan to embrace Islam? Because guess what? If Ramadan, in Ramadan, a shaitan is in hellfire, and their shaitan is in hellfire as well, why are people still mean and evil, and they drink, they fornicate, they cheat, they kill, they take drugs, they kill, and they do all these things? And it's unbelievable how much we Muslims really ignore and are not aware of what the Quran teaches. Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nas, mankind, all of you, Allah talks to all of us. Inna wa'adallahi haqq. Indeed, the promise of Allah is truth, i.e. the resurrection and meeting with Allah, paradise, hellfire, and all those unseen things. And then Allah says, فَلَا تَغُرَّنَّكُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا. So let not the worldly life delude you. And then Allah says, وَلَا يَغُرَّنَّكُمْ بِاللَّهِ الْغَرُورِ. And be not deceived about Allah by the deceiver. And the deceiver here is a shaitan. Then Allah says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Indeed, a shaitan is your sworn enemy. So take him as your sworn enemy. There is no way in the Quran when Allah says, when it comes to Ramadan, I keep you in hellfire. When it comes to Ramadan, his actions are not, they are weakened. When Ramadan comes, I do this to shaitan. Allah in Al-Quran states that Ash-Shaytan is our continuous sworn enemy all the time and everywhere. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Indeed, Ash-Shaytan is an enemy, a sworn enemy to you. So Allah says, return that favor to him. So take him as your sworn, dedicated enemy. And then Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَدْعُ حِزْبَهُ لِيَكُونُوا مِنْ أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. He only invites his party to be among the companions of the blaze. How could Allah be more clear than this? But because we have for so many years believed that comes Ramadan, a shaitan is chained, and the problem is people will tell you the hadith, but they will never tell you that the scholars of Islam never agreed about that. Is it true or not? And there is a great huge number of scholars that do not believe that the shaitan is chained in Ramadan. And I go with the Quran. Shaitan. He is always present all the time. His animosity to us is all the time. So if you keep ruining, if you want to ruin your Ramadan, well, guess what? Feel safe from shaitan during the days of Ramadan, only to be really duped later and cheated and played on by a shaitan. This is why for 30 years you have been fasting, and guess what? You're still the same. Last Ramadan didn't change you. It hasn't brought anything drastic to your life. It's because the original beliefs that you had when you approached Ramadan were wrong. Again, keep believing that spending an hour in the masjid praying Taraweeh is an act of sunnah, and that you have done Taraweeh and recited the Quran. Well, guess what? It is not. And tons of you guys out there believe that when you go to the masjid, pray 1 hour and then come home, you've done your Taraweeh. Well, as I mentioned earlier on, our Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam fasted 9 continuous Ramadans. And he never ever encouraged Muslims to pray in the masjid for Taraweeh, or that he did it for them like he led them for in Ramadan. And when he once happened to pray the night, it's just because he came out and he saw people praying, so he went praying and people came pray with him. He didn't do it deliberately to lead them. That's why the next day when people came, Rasulullah wasn't there, because praying Taraweeh in a group of people is not an act of sunnah. Now, who did it? It was Umar, the second Khalifa radiallahu anhu, who laid down that this deed, and when he one day walked in the masjid in Ramadan, he saw the Sahaba, the companions, Allah be pleased with them, each one of them somewhere praying by himself. So Umar decided out of himself that if I gathered all of them and made them pray together behind one imam, that would be something nice. And he did that. And that's how it became today, aham, sunnah. For 9 years, Rasulullah ﷺ didn't lay down that sunnah. And after his death, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umar, they turned it into a sunnah. And then they tell you, yes, it is a sunnah. You go, really? Of course it is a sunnah. Haven't you heard that Rasulullah ﷺ said, عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ سُنَّةِ وَسُنَّةَ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ مِنْ بَعْدِي. Follow my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa, i.e. my successors that will come behind me. Follow their sunnah and hold it tight with your teeth. Well, guess what? Well, this hadith here, first and before anything, is that this hadith is narrated by one single narrator, whose name is Abdul Rahman ibn Amr al-Sulami. And this man in the science of hadith, as is reported by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, he said that this man is unknown in the sphere of hadith. And Ibn al-Qattan, who is also a great scholar of hadith, said that this man is unknown. So here we are, we Muslims, building our Islam based on a hadith reported by someone, an unknown man. And suddenly, what Abu Bakr and Umar do become a sunnah. Subhanallah. For 9 years, Rasulullah ﷺ didn't do it. And just because Umar did it, it became a sunnah. Wallahi, where are we going? But anyhow, if you wanna ruin your Ramadan this year, go pray in the masjid. The true sunnah that you should do is the one where you pray alone at home. And if you have your wife, pray with her. Otherwise, pray by yourself and your wife by herself. There is no better deed than that Rasulullah ﷺ did for 9 continuous years. Other people will tell you, hang on here. So you are telling us that praying at home is what you should do, when for 1400 years the people have done it, and also there is a hadith that says inna ummati la tajtami'u ala dalala, my ummah, and this hadith is reported by Abi Dawood and At-Tirmidhi and has been made good Hassan by Al-Albani and other people, that my ummah, the Muslim ummah, will never agree on a falsehood. And since Taraweeh have been done since the dawn of man, that is since Abu Umar ibn Khattab until our time, and all the scholars have accepted it, then it is a sunnah. Well, let me tell you, not all scholars have accepted it, and that's one. Two, I personally do not care what 1400 years have been brought us. To me is what Allah says in the Quran and what His Messenger did. And since Rasulullah didn't do it and he never encouraged for it, and there is no hadith about the Taraweeh, any hadith about the Taraweeh were fabricated later to justify what has been done. But it is not the original sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This is why, my sisters and my brothers, if you want to ruin your Ramadan, guess what? Then keep praying Taraweeh in the masjid and fool yourself that you are fulfilling the word of Allah by praying, because you are not. You are just wasting your time. Another thing, the dua in the masjid when the imam makes it after Taraweeh, the end, the long dua, I hate it with every bone in my body. A, it's not sunnah. Two, it's a very long dua. Three, it is like a poetic dua. And four, it doesn't come from the heart. It really doesn't come from the heart. The dua that you want is something that comes out of your own heart. So if you want to ruin your Ramadan, keep carrying the old beliefs that you always carried about Ramadan, apply them this year, because you are going to get the same results as you got the year before, and the year before that, and before, and you keep going back until you reach the day you fasted your first Ramadan. And look at your life from that day until today, how much have you changed? Because Ramadan is the month in which Al-Quran was sent. And in that night is the only night that is blessed, and the great blessings of that night are further explained later on. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr, because in laylatil qadr the angels, gazillions of them, descend to earth, and Jibril, who doesn't come to earth except once every year, and that is in the night where he brought the Quran the very first time. And why is all this crown for this Laylatul Qadr? Is because Al-Quran, that we today ignore day and night. Al-Quran is huda linnas, it's a guidance to mankind. Why has Al-Quran become not a guidance to Muslims themselves? Look at me talking to you in this talk here. Aren't you finding it difficult to get away from those beliefs that you held for years? And what I'm telling you, Allah says in Al-Quran, you find it difficult to believe me? Well, guess what? Because throughout your life, you have prioritized everything else but Al-Quran. Al-Quran, my dear sisters and my brothers, is a beautiful book. The whole month of Ramadan is honored because it carries one night, and that night has been made the most blessed night, is because in it came down the Quran. And also, let me tell you something else. People who read Al-Quran in Ramadan just to get the rewards out of reading Al-Quran, well, guess what? You're not dealing with me. You see, if I asked you to read Al-Quran and I will give you for every letter you read £10 or $10, whatever it is. So when you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you will come to me and you go, give me $190 or £190, because it has 19 letters in it. Well, I will give it to you because you can fool me easily. I don't know why you read it. Is it just to learn from it or just to make money? Well, a lot of people, they read Al-Quran to get the rewards. But you know what the problem is? And this is how you can ruin your life. And that is because when you read Al-Quran, the one who is going to reward you is Allah. The reward is based on your intention as to why you are reading Al-Quran. If you're reading Al-Quran only to get the rewards, you will not see these rewards. Because the great rewards for reading Al-Quran is that you read Al-Quran to make it happen into your lives. So that you practice the teachings in that book, and then your life becomes better and you get extra rewards and you get everything. But if your intention is only to collect rewards, you will not see them, because Allah knows you don't have any intention of doing and following and acting on what you learn. Look at it this way. Remember them days when you were ready or getting ready to do your driving test? How you studied? How you did everything? Did you study just to get the test and then drive in a better life? Or did you study to cheat the inspector or the instructor? Well, guess what? The same thing here. You can't fool Allah. Allah knows your intention. And if you want to get 10 rewards per letter, you're not going to get them. Because Allah in Al-Quran is the only one, as He said in Al-Quran, that يوم القيامة توفون أجوركم. On the day of judgment, that is the day where Allah will decide how many rewards you will get for what action. Allah has not set any reward for any act. And any hadith that tells you if you do this, you get that. If you say subhanallah, you will get a tree in paradise. If you read this Al-Quran, you, for one letter you get 10 rewards. If you do this, you get this extra rewards. مَا قَالَ لَا إِلَٰهِ اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. It would be like he freed 4 of the children of Adam. And all these things, all these ahadith, even if they are authentic, they go headlong against the Quran. Because Allah in Al-Quran has explicitly and directly said that the only one who will decide how many rewards you will get is Allah. Because if the Prophet ﷺ would never say something to contradict the Quran. But for argument's sake, if Rasulullah ﷺ said, when you say Subhanallah, you will get this reward, Allah will take away your sin from you and He will give you an action of good. Okay, free gifts, like you've done nothing, Allah will raise away a sin and will give you a good deed, right? So that's what you say, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. So 4 times you say this, 4 hasanat, 4 good deeds are written for you, and 4 sins are taken away from you. But Allah has made it clear in Al-Quran that you either seek forgiveness for a sin you committed, okay, or when you commit a sin, you repent from it and you do lots of extra deeds to replace that sin with goodness. There is no free rides. Wallahi, 99% of those ahadith where the reward is mentioned are humanly fabricated hadith, because they go headlong against Al-Quran. Now, you find it difficult, right? Well, guess what? What we are supposed to be doing is this. We're supposed to have good intentions, do the acts for the best of what we can, ask Allah for the reward, and ask for His mercy on Judgment Day, that He be generous with us. That's it. There is no decided wages, there are no decided rewards, there is nothing that Allah has put forth. Show me one thing in the Quran where Allah says, you do this, I give you 10 of that. Except when He spoke that Al-Hasana, one good deed, will get you 10 rewards. And only Allah knows the size of that reward. So again, the whole purpose of this little pep talk here, my dear sisters and my brothers, is that you must change the way you look at Ramadan. You really must look at it purely organic. Yes, you will raise your eyebrows when I say things. You will be surprised. You will be like shocked. But the truth of the matter is, it's better be shocked and change your perception about how you see and how you look at Ramadan than leading another Ramadan where you don't eat for 30 days and you start counting the end of Ramadan and after, and then think like the night of 27, that's it, and then the masjid gets empty after the 27th because people, that's it, they prayed it to Taraweeh and end of it, and Ramadan is what, get hungry throughout the day, 1 hour or less in the masjid, complain if the salat is long, and invite someone else to break the iftar at your home so that you get the reward of their fasting. Wallahi al-Azim, Ramadan has become so feeble, so unbelievably away from Al-Quran. So to ruin your Ramadan, Keep thinking like you always did, because you will always get what you always got, and where you always got is where you are right now. Are you happy where you are right now with your Islam? Are you drilled? Can you feel you progressed since last Ramadan? Can you really say that I have become a better person since last Ramadan? Well, when Ramadan comes to it, and that's what I want you to do, when people go to the gym to work out, people go for two things. People go to get results, and others go because they want to go to the gym. The results do not matter to them. Most of the Muslims, and a great number of Muslims these days, is when Ramadan comes, is they go, they do Ramadan, but the results of Ramadan, that is the taqwa, to cut down from your aggression and your transgression against yourselves by committing sins, because those sins you're going to pay very painfully for on Judgment Day, and also your aggression and transgression against the humanity, against the environment, against you, everything. If we really understood why Allah made the outcome from Ramadan is a taqwa, and that is the cut down in transgression, oppression, aggression, then you will find out that by not doing the aggression, transgression, and oppression, you really are an extremely positive human being with little of the sins. And with that, on Day of Judgment, Allah will reward you greatly. But we Muslims today have changed the meaning of Ramadan, and this is why for the last 1400 years, the wrath of Allah is upon us. The wrath of Allah hasn't been lifted upon us. No matter how many years we make dua in Ramadan, I remember as days would make dua in Mecca, Ya Allah, we pray to you, we call upon you to free Palestine. Palestine is not being freed for 70 years. Oh, come on, Allah doesn't listen to our dua? Or are we just not doing what He wants us to do? Ya Allah, we want you to fight America. And then later on, Mr. Sidis now praises America and praises the Jews and praises that. Because why? Because they have given a completely different meaning to Ramadan. Ramadan has become just don't eat the day and go to Taraweeh and get a big long dua and accept to be set free from hellfire. And that's it. It's a go away card. If you want to ruin your Ramadan this year, wallahi, keep thinking about Ramadan like you did before, and then you will ruin your Ramadan and the next one and the one after and the one after and the one after until you meet Allah. And the first question He's going to ask you, I said the outcome of Ramadan is taqwa. What have you done? And then the answers will be extremely difficult to make up. So I pray to Allah that these little pointers here will help you this Ramadan to look completely different to the previous Ramadans. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and I have kept the talk short because there is more I could say, but maybe what I've said should be enough to open up your eyes. If you want to be part of my group, please do send me a message on my WhatsApp message. And that is +44 if you are outside the United Kingdom. But if you are in the UK, just say 078-76-408735. And I see you in Ramadan. There are many pep talks on my YouTube channel about Ramadan. I'd like you to go there and check them out to get the other side of Ramadan, what you should do, what you should do, all that kind of stuff is out there. I'll see you on the other side of the fence, where you will be in the left, change your perception about Ramadan, and we'll have plenty of good time together, inshallah, on the other side. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.